star shine, and its splendor fills up the sky. It's the same that appeared and the wise men revered when hope was born this night. Out upon the snowy fields, there's a silent peace that heals, and it echoes the grace of our Savior's embrace, 'cause hope was born this night. Glory to God in
Morning, church. Merry Christmas to you. Welcome to God's family gathered together. We're glad you're here. If you're new, I'm Pastor Josh, and it is Christmas time. Advent is upon us. The word Advent means literally arrival, and we're celebrating Jesus' arrival in his earthly ministry at Christmas time. So a special thanks to those that have decorated. It's pretty, isn't it? And it's kind of inspiring. Yeah, thank you to the team. It takes a team, so there's a lot of people involved in gathering together, and we're just grateful. We are going to be talking about the story of Jesus from now through Christmas. We're calling this time the story that changed the world. And so this continues our series in Luke. We're taking a break in the middle of the book. We're going back to the very beginning of the book. And in your bulletin are these Advent Reading Plan bookmarks that define what Advent is and allow you to follow along in a reading plan. I do this with another friend of mine. We read during the week what the scripture is going to be. We think about it. We talk about it. That's something you can do on your own or with the spouse or with the friend. And so that's available in your bulletins. We want to invite you back to the Christmas Eve services. We are planning Christmas Eve. We continue to plan gathering together. And we are planning this. It's December 24th, Christmas Eve, at 3 p.m. and 5 p.m., and so we want to encourage you to plan for that, invite somebody. Nursery will be provided, plenty of social distance spacing. Come and celebrate with us. By the way, in your bulletins, all of our COVID protocols are kind of spelled out there, what we're doing, why we're doing it. We encourage you to fill out the registration card, place that in the offering boxes. We would love to know you were here. And then lastly, thank you for packing boxes. 130 Operation Christmas Child boxes were packed. That's the back of a minivan where we packed them up and sent them off. So thank you for doing that. 30 more were packed online. So thank you, church, for just being a part of that ministry. It's wonderful. I just want to open our time in prayer. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we know that during this time we need you. And I pray that you would help us understand what that looks like from the Christmas story. That you are present, that you care, that you love us. Help us with our time together to really worship you from the depths of our hearts, to recognize your presence. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, because it is Advent, we are going to light our first Advent candle. The Advent wreath is a circle. I say this at a lot of weddings about our rings that symbolize the unending love of God. The Advent wreath is a circle that symbolizes the unending love of God's unending love and faithfulness. And so the light reminds us of Jesus, the light of the world. This morning, Mike and Beth Dittman will be sharing verses and lighting the hope candle.
Psalm 39, verse 7. And now, Lord, for what do I wait? My hope is in you. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Psalm 147, verse 11. The Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love. We light this candle to celebrate the hope we have through salvation in Christ alone.
Amen. Would you stand and let's sing together?
Come, all you faithful. Thank you. time. Praise your name forever, Lord. Over those words, those truths. God, you are our Emmanuel. You are with us to the point where you came to this earth to be among us, to be with us, to live for us, and to die for us, Lord. We just praise you for being so present in the midst of us, Lord. Lord, I do pray for us as we go through the season still that you'll just remind us of the hope that we have in you through this little baby. We have all the hope we need. And we know the whole story as he went to the cross for us, and our hope is so secure in that. We thank you for being with us again. Pray for us as we turn to your word. Pray that you would ready our hearts and our minds to receive what you have for us today. And pray that you would help us to leave encouraged in our faith. We love you and we praise you for this day. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. And children are dismissed. 3 years through fourth grade are dismissed.
Awesome. Thank you, worship team. Well, there were some gloomy and overcast days this week. The sun poked through a couple times, but most of the week it was overcast and gray, and that can kind of be hard as winter is upon us. We know the days are getting shorter. Days are going to continue to get shorter until December 21st, and we've got this long winter ahead of us. And yet the lights are beginning to shine, and we've made the turn toward Christmas. Sparkles and decorations, Christmas music and preparations, those are all kind of in full swing, which can all be exciting and fun and sort of offset the gloom and the cold of winter. But the fact remains that often in this season, there are these two parallel tracks of joy and sadness for many of us. I find, even as a pastor, that when the weather is more gloomy, that people's perspectives on life are a little bit more gloomy. And when the weather clears up, we're a little bit more like, oh, I think it'll be okay. Like, so there's a number of reasons. Environmental, family memories, loneliness, busyness, loss, all sorts of things. And so here's the thing. Today, if you find yourself in that kind of place where there's some happiness, but there's also some sadness, if you ever lean in that direction, I really want to encourage you from God's word today. If you've got a Bible, would you open it with me? We're in Luke chapter 1. This Advent, we're turning back the clock from the middle of Luke to the first chapters of Luke, Luke 1 and 2, the Christmas chapters. And what we're going to find today is this encouragement. When times are dark, when hurt is present, keep holding on to the Lord. He's faithful. He's always working. If sadness ever settles into the cracks of your life, if it ever colors the edges of your relationships, keep praying, keep waiting, keep hoping, keep trusting. Joy is just around the corner. How do I know that? Because our God is a promise keeper. And the story of Jesus is all about him bringing joy and light into a dark world and our dark lives. He has initiated in history. He has a plan. That's what we celebrate at Christmas. So before we dig in, would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, to open again to the story of our Savior is a blessing for us. It's an encouragement to our hearts. And I pray that encouragement into the lives of the people gathered today. I pray that you would sort of get me out of the way and let your story come through. Allow our time to be a time of connecting again with what matters most, Lord. We pray this humbly in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so when the parallel tracks of joy and sadness become the pathway of our lives, the Christmas story is perfect. And the opening paragraphs have three areas of focus that I want to look at today and use to work through the story. They are character, prayer, and belief. Those are the areas of focus I want to think with you in this pre-Christmas story today. Character, prayer, and belief. First, character. This really is a great story. This story that we're going to look at in these verses, it's about Mary's cousin, Elizabeth, and Elizabeth's husband, Zechariah. So Mary, the mother of Jesus, her cousin, Elizabeth, and Elizabeth's husband, Zechariah. Their character shines through this story. So follow along as I read the opening, Luke 1, verses 5 to 7. In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah, and he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and statutes of the Lord, but they had no child because Elizabeth was barren and both were advanced in years. So the pre-Christmas story, the setting before Jesus comes, is honestly a bit gloomy, with only the character of this couple kind of glimmering through the haze. So look at it with me. As any good historian would, Luke sets this account in history. He mentions that this is the time where Herod was king of Judea. Herod the Great accomplished a lot. He reigned from 37 BC to 4 BC. He refurbished the temple of God. He built a lot of great things, but he was a brutal ruler. And it was an oppressive time for God's people. Shining through the darkness is this, the character of this couple, Elizabeth and Zechariah. Both were from the priestly line of Aaron. It was sort of a double blessing. Both were getting on in years. According to verse 6, both were said to be righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and statutes of the Lord. So here's the picture. It's a distinguished elderly couple living in the hill country near Jerusalem, kind of like an old country pastor and his wife. They're steady, they're simple, they're active in ministry, they're nearing the age of retirement. They're not sinless, but they're faithful. There was only one cloud that cast a shadow over their happiness. Verse 7, but they had no child because Elizabeth was barren. That word is like a punch to the gut. There is a lifetime of heartache behind that phrase. This was possibly the greatest disappointment of Elizabeth's life. At any time in history, this is incredibly difficult, but especially then. Kent Hughes said, in any culture, infertility is an aching disappointment, and for some, an almost unbearable stress. But the burden cannot be compared to that borne by childless women in ancient Hebrew culture, because barrenness was considered a disgrace, even a punishment. Which begs the question for so many of us, if we take a step back from even that specific hurt, and we talk about hurt and pain and loss a little bit more generally, we can begin to ask, why is this happening? Is this a punishment? Is God punishing me? And this is where I kind of want to speak into that. All of us essentially will experience in our life difficulty, from momentary to monumental. Elizabeth was not ungodly. She was a woman of character. This was not a punishment. Now, some sins have consequences, but much of our suffering has nothing to do with our own sin. Philip Ryken said, sometimes Christians suffer for exactly the opposite reason of their own sin. They suffer for the sake of righteousness. Sometimes making a choice of integrity actually has consequences in this world that are negative and produce suffering. Sometimes we suffer from the sins of others. And sometimes God allows us to suffer because he wants to be glorified through our suffering. Most of the time, we don't know what his reasons are. And therefore, we should be very careful not to reach the wrong conclusions about why something bad is happening to us or to someone else. For Elizabeth, the hurt was real. The pain was deep. And it echoed the pain of other women of faith in the Bible, Hagar, Leah, Hannah. In fact, a lot of the story of Luke 1 has parallels. It tells a true story, but it's arranged in such a way that there's poetic parallels to real stories of the Old Testament. It ties into the fact that we've been waiting for all these generations for Jesus. Jesus is the answer to our deepest pain. The Christian perspective on suffering is that even in great hurt, there's still a way for us to glorify God, to know His presence, to trust His plan. So I have a question for you. And before I ask the question, I just need to tell you a little bit of what our family does. At times when we gather, and we did this over Thanksgiving, we'll be around the Thanksgiving table. At the end of dinner, we pull out this book called 3,000 Questions. We'll open randomly to a page and kind of pick a question that's kind of a conversation starter for us as a family. And then we talk about it, we think about it as a family. I want to invite you into that experience, okay? So I want to give you a question that you might talk about and think about as a family as you go home today, or as an individual, contact me, let me know what your answer is. Here's the question. Who is someone that you look at, that you have known in your life, who is someone who is a person of character? Someone that stands out as you look at the people that you know and have known over the course of your life, who lives with character. I'm not talking about intelligence or stature or wealth necessarily. I'm talking about character born of difficulty. Character that is based in faithfulness. Character that no matter the circumstances on the outside, there's a steadiness on the inside, not perfection, but a steadiness, somebody that you really respect. Who would that be? I think it's important for us to know of those examples in our life and to share about why that's been an influence for us. If you can remember, talk about that today. Maybe over lunch, maybe with somebody that you know. That was Zechariah and Elizabeth. They were a couple of character. You would have looked at them and thought, I want to be like them. I want to be like him. I want to be like her. Introduced to us in verses 5 to 7. But then there's a moment that happens in verses 8 to 17 where the focus next for us is prayer. First focus is character. The second is prayer and the importance of prayer. The power of prayer. Follow along as I read verses 8 to 17. Now while he was serving, this is Zechariah, as priest before God, when his division was on duty, according to the custom of the priesthood, he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside at the hour of incense, and there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great before the Lord, and he must not drink wine or strong drink. And he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just to make ready for the Lord a people prepared." Gabriel, the glorious and mighty angel of the Lord shows up to Zechariah all because of prayer. Verse 13, but the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard." Friends, when joy and sadness are the paths of our lives, care about character and hold on to prayer. Keep hoping, keep seeking God, keep trusting Him, keep praying. Here's some background. Zechariah was a priest at a time when there were a lot of priests. Priests were coming out the ears of the people of Israel. Tons of priests. And so they divided them into 24 divisions, with each division serving 2 weeks a year plus the national festivals. A lot of priests actually lived a distance from Jerusalem into the hill country and had other vocations during the rest of the year. So it was an honor to serve. But Zechariah was then chosen by lot, by chance, for an even greater honor during his days at the temple. Every day, prayers were offered in the morning and in the evening in the holy place. So the way the temple is divided is that there are courts for Jews and Gentiles, and then there's a court for the Jews, and then there is the holy place, and then the most holy place. Every day in the holy place, just outside of the most holy place where God's presence dwelt, in the holy place was an altar of incense in the middle, a table for the showbread to the right, and a lampstand to the left. And every day in the morning and then in the evening, they lit incense and they offered prayers to the Lord. And priests were chosen by lot. And once you were chosen, then you were ineligible to do that ever again in your life. So it was a once-in-a-lifetime thing. This was probably the apex of Zechariah's life and ministry. Now, we don't know the specific wording of his prayer. We don't know the content of the prayer that he prayed that was heard by God. Maybe it was that he was chosen by lot, and he was at home the day that he would leave and go and enter into the holy place and offer incense. And he hugged his wife before he left, and he squeezed her tight, and he pulled her back by the shoulders and looked into her teary eyes, and he said, I know. I'll pray that prayer one more time for a son that we've been praying. And as he left, he knew that they were past that season of their life, but he's going into the holy place. This is a once-in-a-lifetime shot. I'm gonna pray that prayer again anyways. Or maybe it was his priestly duty to intercede for the people of Israel. And so he went in and he prayed for their deliverance, for the oppression to be lifted of the Roman people, for the Messiah to finally come and be the fulfillment of all of God's promises. We don't know exactly what he prayed. If he's like any of us, it was probably this combination, this Thanksgiving fruit salad jello mold of a prayer, you know, all of it's mixed together. And he brought both personal and priestly prayers into the holy place. And so it was that he entered the table to the right, the incense altar in the middle, the lampstand on the left. Zechariah entered, and into that space also enters Gabriel, standing right next to the altar. Have you ever seen a professional athlete in person? Somebody that plays for the NBA, a giant hulk of a football player that plays for the NFL, and kind of been impressed with just the sheer size and kind of athletic build of that athlete. From what I understand in Scripture, if we as human beings were ever to see an angel in person, it would totally overwhelm us spiritually, emotionally, psychologically, to the point where we're just in fear, we're in amazement, we're in awe. And that's not even the glory of the living God in all its splendor before us. Gabriel, the glorious, the spectacular and resplendent messenger of salvation that God also sent to Mary and before that sent to Daniel, shows up in all his grandeur, but with words of encouragement and comfort for Zechariah. Verse 13. Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John, which means God is gracious. God is gracious, certainly. And then verse 14, and you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. Joy and gladness and rejoicing for this old couple that would be parents, and for many others as well. Joy. Joy is a consistent theme in Luke, and this is the first time that it kind of explodes onto the scene. Joy is a consistent theme in Luke because Jesus brings joy. And their son John would be the one to stir it up even before it was brought into the world in Christ. Then Zechariah is given really specific directions about this boy. Name him John, verse 13. Limit his drink, verse 15. And watch how the Holy Spirit fills him and uses him, verses 15 and 16. Even from birth, he will be filled with the Holy Spirit. So this part of limiting his drink is part of a Nazirite vow that's talked about in Numbers 6. Normally, in the culture of God's people, in the Hebrew culture, moderate drinking was just part of the culture. But some prophets or priests were set apart. John was like that. Set apart for holy service. An unusual person called to an unusual ministry. Other prophets have been anointed by the Spirit. John would be filled with the Spirit. Why? Because he would prepare the way. Verse 17, and he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready for the Lord a people prepared. Now, as Zechariah would have seen Gabriel, he would have been in awe. His eyes would have been wide. But when he heard what Gabriel said, his jaw would have dropped at that point. What Zechariah heard in verse 17 essentially is God's messenger telling Zechariah, your son will be the Elijah promised by the prophet Malachi. Your son will prepare the way for the Messiah. Your son will get everyone ready to be saved. You and your wife will be the father and mother of the forerunner. Fulfillment and salvation are coming. The Messiah is here. It's time. And the prayers of Zechariah and Elizabeth are what stirred Gabriel to come to Zechariah. Here's another question. First question, who do you know that has character that you look up to in your life? Second question, who do you know that is a prayer? That is a committed prayer? As I think back in my life and in the communities of faith that I've been a part of, a lot of the people that I think of that fit this description are elderly. In a place in their lives where they just consistently pray. They lift up other people. They lift up their kids and their grandkids and their great-grandkids. Who do you know that is a prayer? Second, who do you know that needs prayer? As I think about each of these three principles, the areas of focus of character and prayer and belief, I kind of think that prayer is the area that we miss the most in our culture, maybe in our community right now, maybe in this community. Maybe we need to hear this. As I read this, I just get convicted about it. And I realize I need to be a more consistent prayer. And so maybe let's start, let's not waste any time. Let's pray right now. I want to pray. Heavenly Father, as we just mention the word prayer, let's not hesitate and let's just jump in and say, Lord, we need you. As I think right now, people are coming to my mind. I want to pray for Jim Squiller as he has just experienced a stroke in the last day. And I want to pray that you would encourage him and heal him and allow him, Lord, to gain strength. I want to lift up to you just a number of families that I know are hurting. And I want to pray that your presence makes the difference in their lives. Not that there's all of a sudden this surfacey, giddy kind of smiley happiness, but it's a deep joy from you that you care for us, you love us, you are here for us, and that there is a path forward to love and hope and life and peace. And Lord, as we think of these principles and experience them afresh and anew as we read your word, stir us to not just hear this, but respond in action in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Not the closing prayer of the message. There's still more, but why wait, right? We hear somebody say you need to pray. Sometimes as believers we say to one another, oh, I'll pray for you. I've tried to, when I say that, just stop right there and pray. Like, so that I didn't just lie, and that I don't forget. Let's be a people of prayer. That was Zechariah and Elizabeth. But they weren't perfect. They were people of prayer, but they weren't perfect. And we see that next in verses 18 to 25. And belief is the focus. So character, prayer, and now belief. Listen to verses 18 to 25. And Zechariah said to the angel, "How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years." By the way, this was a wise couple. He had figured a lot of things out. He can call himself old, but you never call your wife old. He said, "I'm old. My wife is just advanced in years." That's all, you know. Verse 19, and the angel answered him. So Zechariah had this question, and listen to Gabriel's response. And the angel answered him, "I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God, and I was sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. And behold, you will be silent and unable to speak until the day that these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time." And the people were waiting for Zechariah, and they were wondering at his delay in the temple. And when he came out, he was unable to speak to them. And they realized that he had seen a vision in the temple. And he kept making signs to them and remained mute. And when his time of service was ended, he went to his home. After these days, his wife Elizabeth conceived. And for 5 months, she kept herself hidden, saying, "Thus the Lord has done for me in the days when he looked on me to take away my reproach among people." So what was promised came true. But in the moment, Zechariah doubted when he should have believed. So that's the third focus: character, prayer, and belief. Our calls to believe. Believe the basics. God is able to do immeasurably more than all that we ask or imagine. So the objection that Zechariah raised in verse 18 is the objection that people always raise. We get stuck in our own human, limited perspective. He didn't believe in the power of God. As Philip Ryken said, he had his biology right, but not his theology. This is where people always struggle. They believe that the Bible was written by men, but they doubt that it was written by God. They believe that Jesus was a man, but they doubt that he was also God. They believe that Jesus died, but they doubt that he rose again. It takes faith to accept God's word, to receive God's son, to enter God's salvation, faith in an all-powerful God. And in the moment, Zechariah just wondered. I mean, he really was a good guy, and he only did what most of us would have done. He just wanted to be sure, which is exactly why the story is in the Bible. Luke could have left it out. He could have skipped from verse 17 when Gabriel gave the promise to verse 24 when Elizabeth celebrated. But we have in the Christmas story right away this picture of a man that was imperfect. He loved the Lord. He was righteous before the Lord. He had a wonderful marriage, but he was imperfect just for a moment. And we get to hear that. God works with us even while we're in process. And I love how Gabriel responded. So intense, wasn't he? "And behold, you will be silent and unable to speak." "I'm Gabriel. Who do you think I am?" he says. "I'm Gabriel. What I say, you can pretty much count on it. It's going to happen." These days, I find that most of us we really appreciate clear, firm, loving authority, frankly. This is the boundary. You just crossed it. There's consequences. The best parents balance that well with consistency. The best coaches, they're tough, but you kind of know they're in your court. You know that they're for you. The best representatives of God, be they a priest or an angel or a pastor or a shepherd of some kind, balance truth and grace. Jesus was the best person ever to live to do this the best, balancing truth and grace. What happens next in verses 21 to 23 is actually kind of funny. It's Zechariah not being able to speak. He had just seen the most spectacular vision. He had just heard the most wonderful news, and he couldn't talk about it. On Thanksgiving Day, we as a family Zoomed with some of our relatives in Alaska and in California. And on the California Zoom, one of our nieces is in college studying sign language. She knows it fluently, and she's studying sign language more in depth. And one of our nephews just started studying sign language in high school. He basically doesn't know it. But one of the aunts was like, hey, why don't you practice some sign language together? And so the niece was doing sign, and the nephew didn't have a clue. He's like, I don't know. I don't know what you're saying. You know. It was actually kind of funny as we saw them try to communicate with one another. Whether it's sign language or a foreign language, when two people can't communicate, and they have to resort to charades, it's like equal portions frustrating and helpless and funny. That was Zechariah. But I guarantee you this, when he got home, words or no words, Elizabeth knew. She knew exactly what was going to happen. The opening of this story ends with Elizabeth rejoicing. It's signature Luke for him to notice how the gospel affects people who are hurting. He records Elizabeth's prayer of rejoicing in verse 25. Thus the Lord has done for me in the days when he looked on me to take away my reproach among the people. You hear the culture at the time. She believed what God said. I love this. Such an example of faith for us. Believe the basics. God wants us to take him at his word. So whatever God says, believe it. He has said that Jesus died and rose again. Believe it. He said that he'll forgive anyone who trusts in Jesus. So surrender your life to Jesus and believe it. He said that he will never leave you or forsake you. So believe that God will be present to the very end. In the clouds or in the sun. If we're old or if we're young, when the days are short, when the days are sunny and long, when we are feeling loved, when we are hurt, believe the good news of Jesus. Here's how the Christmas story starts, friends. It starts with a cloudy day, with a gloomy time, with an oppressive environment. But by faith, when the times are bleak for us, our focus can begin with character. And so I want to encourage you with this. Care about character. Think this week about Zechariah and Elizabeth and how they lived. Care about character. Second, with prayer, don't delay. Pray for God to provide. Pray for provision. And trust that he will provide in his way. That God will answer your prayers. Trust that he will do that. Pray. And then third, believe. Just believe the basics. Believe that God is who he said he is, that he has done what he has done, that he will do what he said he will do. Believe it. Now, if I can be honest with you, sometimes I don't exactly know how to preach to all of us together. We're all at so many different places. There's sunny days and cloudy days represented here. There's challenge and difficulty and hurt and joy and all of it mixed together. And sometimes the oppressiveness of the culture at the time that Luke wrote this feels relevant to us, and other times it doesn't. But on the other hand, I know we all need God. And I know that this is a challenging year and that we are experiencing challenging times and that even if things are going pretty well, there is a guarantee for us that at some point in our lives, things will be challenging. And so this Christmas, would you just remember with me, could we be reminded together that God's timing is often not our timing? We can easily become troubled and fearful and disgraced and impatient, which can lead us to question and doubt and disbelief. Remember that waiting is part of being faithful. It's to be expected. And remember Elizabeth and Zechariah this week. I don't know what the setting might be in your life, but remember them. And just hold on to God's character. Let's keep it simple and just take God at His word. Trust Him. Trust the character of our Lord. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we want to be very attentive to You and to recognize that at the center of Christmas is truly the person of Jesus. Lord, we want to thank You for this couple and their steadiness and their commitment to You and to one another. For the way that the Christmas story starts with them, Lord, with some starts and some stops, some good moments and some almost funny moments. But also when the tracks of joy and sadness become our path, Lord, would You help us to keep our eyes on You? Would You draw us into a life of character and prayer and belief? Wherever we're at, each person here, I pray that You'd kind of point us forward and help us because we really need that. Thank You for these moments today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing of Christ. Would you stand?
Thank you.
So a reminder about those questions. Share with each other just who stands out in character to you in your life and who stands out as a prayer in your life and who needs prayer. Just encouraging you as you go from here and receive this benediction from the end of Romans, pointing to the person of Christ. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to the gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but has now been disclosed, to the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you this week. Merry Christmas.